I'm delighted to welcome all of you here. I'm Jim McAdams, if you don't know me. I'm the director of the Nanavik Institute for European Studies. And I want to talk for a minute just about this prize, the Shannon Prize, the Laura Shannon Prize in European Studies. We are very, very proud of this prize because what it has evolved into is arguably the leading European Studies prize in the United States, and to the best of my knowledge, the only major European Studies award. This is something we're particularly proud of, this prize, because it captures what we try to do at the Nanavik Institute, which is not simply to look at any single country's experience, but to think in broad terms about Europe, however Europe is construed. So allow me to read, first of all, from the description of the award. I'm looking on my list here. yes, I found it. The Shannon Prize is awarded annually to the author of the best book in European studies that transcends a focus on any one country, state, or people to stimulate new ways of thinking about contemporary Europe as a whole, and recognizes books alternately in humanities or history and the social sciences. This year's prize is for the humanities for an extraordinary book, which one of my colleagues will introduce. Let me first say, though, that an indication of the quality of the prize is the ease that we have in getting the leading Europeanists in the world to sit as jurors. If you can't get the leading people, that should make you worry about your prize. In our case, we find that it is quite easy to get people such as, in this year's prize jury, John Hare, who is the Noah Porter Professor of Philosophical Theology at the Yale Divinity School, Anne Lake Prescott, who is the Helen Gotthard Altschul Professor of English at Barnard College, Columbia University, Roger Scruton, who is a fellow at the Ethics and Policy Center in Washington and a very prolific commentator on modern society. We always have two members of the Notre Dame faculty, and for this past jury, we had Carl Omrichs, the McMahon-Hank Professor of Philosophy, as well as our colleague Ingrid Rowland, who teaches in Rome, who is a professor of architecture. To introduce our guest and our honoree, I'm pleased to introduce to you Joe Rosenberg, a distinguished Nanavik Institute fellow. Joe is a professor, Joseph, in the Program of Liberal Studies, which is a distinctive program at Notre Dame. And I'm quite envious of this. He studies 20th century British, Irish, and American fiction, which sounds so much more like what I should have studied when I was in graduate school. And so I'm pleased to invite Joseph to come up here and to introduce our guest.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Much, Jim. I have a friend, a scholar of literary modernism and the avant-garde, who has a cruel game that he likes to play at conferences. It consists of dropping the names of 20th century avant-garde Eastern European authors one should have read but hasn't in order to intimidate his fellow conference goers. Names like Bohumil Hrabal, Bruno Schulz, and Danilo Kish. Happily, thanks to the work of Mark Thompson, my friend has just lost the major ace up his sleeve. Birth Certificate is a truly remarkable work, at once a biography and a piece of very fine literary criticism, a meditation on personal loss and the horrors of nationalism. birth certificate offers a careful and sensitive telling of a life that experienced some of the last century's greatest cruelties. Kish's father was a Hungarian Jew, his mother a Montenegrin of Orthodox faith. His father disappeared into the Shoah, and the son, cosmopolitan, anti-communist, and passionately opposed to the myth-drenched nationalisms of his native lands, grew up chafing against the hypocrisies of Titoism. His writing pioneered a modernist technique in his language, fulminated against literary kitsch, and sketched out a literary heritage, quote, with no sun as its center and its tyrant. Joyce and Borges were influences on his writing, which nevertheless is stunningly original. And such a remarkable writer demands a remarkable biographer, and you found that in Mark Thompson. While he is currently a reader in modern history at the University of East Anglia, his CV doesn't exactly resemble that of most academics, including positions as the head of media analysis for the biggest peacekeeping mission mounted by the UN, the first political officer to serve with the UN's smallest peacekeeping mission, the spokesman and head of media affairs for the mission to Croatia of the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, and the Balkans program director of the International Crisis Group. His first book, A Paper House, was a political travelogue describing the Federal Republic of Yugoslavia under the brink of dissolution. It was followed by Forging War, an account of the media manipulation that took place before and after and during the wars of Yugoslav succession, and the White War, the first comprehensive narrative history in English of the part Italy played in the First World War. The White War won Penn England's Hessel Tiltman Prize and was shortlisted for the Orwell Prize for Outstanding Political Writing. And much like the work of George Orwell and Danilo Kish, Thompson's writing is resolutely attentive to the relationship between words and the world, and nowhere more than in Birth Certificate. In homage to Kish's exuberant formal inventiveness, Birth Certificate isn't organized in the linear historical fashion of conventional biographies, but rather as a text about a text, a series of commentaries on a single short piece that Kish once published called Birth Certificate. As usual with both Kish and Thompson, however, the Birth Certificate is no such thing. It's a miniature autobiography that freely moves between fact and the fantastic, deliberately embellishing and appropriating stories for thematic effect. Thompson's method of close reading, commenting on Kish's sentences clause by clause, becomes a delicate way of illuminating these various repressions and additions and the historical catastrophes that lie behind them. The 2016 Shannon Prize in Contemporary European Studies is just one mark of the achievement of Birth Certificate. Please join me in welcoming its author, Mark Thompson.
Dear Jim McAdams and Joe Rosenberg, thank you both very much indeed. I'd like to thank also right away Mrs. Laura Shannon and her husband Michael, and the jurors, of course, and the Nanavik Institute in its entirety for the honour of this occasion. In a collection of maxims called Advice to a Young Writer, Kish said, accept with equanimity the prizes that princes may award you, but do nothing to deserve them. Now, as a writer who hasn't been young for quite a long time, I feel under no pressure to show equanimity. I accept the Laura Shannon Prize with immense pleasure and delight and gratitude. I wanted to start today with some images of the man himself to have in your mind. This is Kish with Mirjana Miocinovic. There is a beautiful word in their language, saputnik or saputnica in the feminine, meaning traveling companion, literally, but also in the journey that is life, in the sense that we use the word soulmate, for example. Mirjana was Kish's first and longest-lasting saputnica, and up to the present day as the editor of his work. Pascal Delpech, the second Saputnitsa is with Mirjana the co-executrix of his estate. He brought them together in his will, and they have honored him and his work together in every way that they can. I also want to show you this picture, Kish looking rather soulful, but holding a volume of Nietzsche, which suits my purposes, as you'll see. And finally, this rather grainy image tells a good deal about Kish and his milieu, the official culture of communist Yugoslavia. Well, he had several milieu. This was one of them. The sponsorship of culture in communist countries is a fascinating topic in itself, and much has been studied and written. I don't think the last word has been said yet. I would recommend a particular book by a Hungarian intellectual, Miklos Horosty, who is actually a friend of Kish, as it turns out. The book is called The Velvet Prison, Artists Under State Socialism. And this picture shows one of the cells in that velvet prison. It's a ceremony in Budapest in May 1978, I believe. Three Yugoslav writers are being rewarded for their services to Hungarian culture. As you may know, there was a big Hungarian minority in Yugoslavia. I don't know the man on the left shaking hands with the ambassador, I believe the ambassador, but the one on the at the back is Ivan Lalic, who was a fine poet. But look at Kish in the center, the odd man out, with open collar, arms crossed, and a coolly appraising expression, having just accepted the Prince's Prize with perfect equanimity. The central principle of Kish's thinking about art and of his practice as a writer is that ethics and aesthetics are inseparable. You cannot write as a free person, standing outside social conventions so that you can question them and then include them as material in your work, if as a person you don't act independently towards those conventions. That doesn't mean necessarily opposing them, but it means being independent of them. This is the picture of someone who values his independence far more than the bauble which he has just received. I want to speak about Kish's non-fiction as well, but fiction is the place to start because fiction is where Kish does his best thinking. His first published story saw print when he was just 18, a schoolboy in Montenegro. It's called The Red Bull. It's very short, about 600 words. A girl has killed herself by jumping in front of a tram or streetcar. We don't see the suicide in the story. We overhear a number of witnesses to the act, whose comments are casually cruel or foolish, and we glimpse a body. Music from a nearby cafe provides a banal soundtrack. The narrator looks at the scene with horror and shame, which he tries to hide so that he would be similar in every way to the people around him, as he says, similar in every way. This anxiety to assimilate makes him try to imitate the coarse voyeurism of the people around him. His instinct is to protect himself by concealment. Then he imagines that the girl was a toreador and the tram is a red bull rearing over its crushed victim. The crowd appears to applaud the bull and hiss the bloody toreador. The tram then lurches into motion. The crowd melts away. The body is removed, and the story ends with the strains of the cafe band faintly audible. Kish is just beginning his quest for a narrative form that will be equal to the subject that has begun to demand his attention. 10 more years will pass before he can find a satisfactory form in a wonderful book called Garden Ashes. Sadly, the translation's not wonderful, but the book is. And more years again will pass before the subject finds its definitive form in the novel called Hourglass, which is superbly translated, by the way. This subject pressing upon him, insisting on fictional working out, was the disappearance of his father. Joe rightly used the word disappearance as the key word, of his father in the Holocaust. For his father was a Hungarian Jew living with his family in provincial Hungary, rounded up after the Nazi occupation in 1944 and deported to Auschwitz. Around this vanishing, this loss, were, of course, Kish's own childhood and family life with his mother and sister. They surround this space, this void. Kish did not write or talk about his father's death or murder. The word he used was disappearance. The distinction matters. Maybe some of you have read a recent book by Otto Dov Kulka, an Israeli scholar, called Landscapes of the Metropolis of Death. Kulka was a little boy, Jewish, from Czechoslovakia, transported with his mother to Auschwitz. And his book is a memoir and a reflection on memory together. There's a passage, unforgettably poignant, where the author recounts the separation from his mother in July 1944, which incidentally would have been the same month when Edward Kish arrived there. Kulka writes of how his mother disappeared. This is his verb, disappeared. Who was Orpheus there and who Eurydice? That is not clear to me, he writes. But my mother did not turn her head and went from that place and disappeared. The boy Otto's experience was of disappearance, just as the boy Danilo's experience was of disappearance. They did not experience the deaths of their parents, only their vanishing. And the integrity of this experience, the integrity of that experience had to be maintained, I think honored. I think that's how the pressure of expression was felt in both cases. Going back to that early story by Kish, I think it's a parable of history as brute force. I don't believe the tram is meant to represent fascism or communism, even if the bull is red. It is history. This antithesis between inhuman force and frail humanity recurs throughout Kish's writing. In the work of his maturity, he found more convincing and imaginatively engaging ways to make us see the antithesis. And it's a huge challenge in fiction, not so much to evoke the plight of a victim, although the elaboration of a narrative about someone who is doomed to lose is fraught with aesthetic risks. Not so much that, though, as to evoke convincingly the antagonist, the juggernaut, the steamroller of history. The point of departure for Kish is always experience. His mature work creates perspectives on history that respect specific experience, if not one's own, then one's imagination of what experience in such a situation could be. For the main character in the novel Hourglass, whom we know only by his initials E.S., the inexorable force of history has many faces and many names. It is the Orthodox Christian priest who may or may not grant him the baptismal certificates for his children that can save them. It is the police interrogator who compels him to describe and account for his actions, his words, his thoughts about his words, his dreams, and his desires. And it is the Hungarian policeman who, and he foresees this exactly, will, before very long, ride into his village on their bicycles with black feathers in their black gendarme hats, like latter-day horsemen of the apocalypse. History resides in the unequal relationship between parties, where the balance of coercive power is not in question, not open to dispute. All that remains to be settled are the terms which the stronger party will exact from the weaker. Whether the stronger party feels that he or she or it is making history or indeed being history is beside the point. You may object that there is more to history than this, that deliberation and compromise are no less entitled to their place in our consideration of history than confrontation and strife, that Tolstoy, for example, shows a much more richly textured sense of what history can be. And you would be right. But the history which compelled Kish to write was not that history of change, adaptation, and adjustment, let alone a pageant of unfolding liberty or democracy. It was the history of the regimes which careened insanely around much of Europe during the last century. And those regimes were millenarian, claiming to be the endpoints of history, the final expression of political and even philosophical ideas, the penultimate or definitive forms of statehood. And the insane careening continues. It might seem nowadays that Kish's work, which is sort of framed by the Second World War and the Cold War, became historical in November 1989, when the Berlin Wall was breached, less than a month after Kish's own death. If he was, as Milan Kundera has praised him for being, the only writer who turned Stalinist terror, the struggle against Nazism and the Holocaust into great poetry, the only one, and I'm quoting Kundera, who never sacrificed so much as a phrase of his books to political commonplaces, then may it not be that he is now purely historical, a writer whose salience pertains to his own epoch, circumscribed by the experience to which he was loyal, an epoch that is now past? Well, ideology and coercion remain decisive in our lives. The arena where these forces are seen most nakedly has shifted eastwards. But Europe and North America remain deeply implicated, complicit, in the forms currently taken by those unequal relationships between parties. An official report was finally published in the UK last July, after many years' delay, into the decisions which led the United Kingdom to join the invasion of Iraq in 2003. I won't digress here on the momentous consequences of those decisions, you know them. Suffice to say that the day after this report was released, a former prime minister went on BBC radio to justify yet again what he had done. And if I'm lucky, I'll be able to play you a little bit of that.
Going on in the Middle East, which is all to do with, can these countries get to religiously tolerant and pluralistic societies? Can they get to rule-based economies and democracy? And I'm looking at it and I'm thinking, okay, what we did in removing Saddam had terrible consequences that we did not foresee, and I understand all the criticisms. But when I look at it today, I think still that we moved with the grain of where the future is going to be in these countries and in this region.
Roy Scranton of this university has just published a very fine novel about the Iraq invasion and its meanings, its continuing meanings. Near the start of his novel, one character is musing about a veteran who's just returned from Iraq. What would it feel like to do something like that, she wonders. Break a world in two and walk away. I think this video indicates one possible answer, one actual answer. There's far too much to say about it, and I only want here to draw attention to the politician's manner on one hand and his metaphor on the other. The great critic William Empson once observed that when a man is dutifully deceiving himself, he will often admit the truth in his metaphors. The politician's manner here is ingratiating. He understands all the criticisms. He's told us so. His metaphor tells a different story. We moved with the grain of where the future is going to be. The logical circularity is the point. The future is a dimension, unknowable. It isn't a place. If it were a place, how would he know its location? He speaks of the grain, which in friendly way evokes polished wood or even wheat fields, but he means gleaming steel tracks laid down to a certain destination. In that advice to a young writer that I quoted at the start, Kish said, "Do not get obsessed with the urgency of history, and do not believe in the metaphor about the locomotives of history. Do not, therefore, climb aboard the locomotives of history, for they are nothing but a silly metaphor." He also said, "Do not believe in utopian projects, except in those you are creating yourself." So the eagerness to please and the air of strenuous self-deprecation in that video mean that it may not sound like an ironclad political ideology, but it is one. The truth is in the metaphor, which reveals convictions that possess the blindness and self-righteousness of the ideologies that afflicted Europe and the world beyond Europe in the lifetime of Daniel O'Kish, that possess above all the potential to inflict immense harm in the conviction that this harm is a price worth paying for the ultimate benefit of those people, or at least their surviving descendants. This reasoning is implicit in the metaphor about the grain of the future, and it puts the speaker in bad company. In March 1992, as the Serbian attack on Bosnia was in its final stages of preparation, the Bosnian Serb leader, who was recently sentenced to 40 years in prison, told a Bosnian Muslim politician, this is history, this is war. I am ready to sacrifice this entire generation, he means of Bosnian Serb young men, military age, this entire generation, if it means that future generations will live better. Kish was fascinated by the blinding, self-blinding power of political ideology. And his book of stories, called A Tomb for Boris Davidovich, is about revolutionaries who commit themselves to the Soviet project of world revolution and, as a result, perpetrate horrific crimes. The stories do not investigate the process by which the characters come to commit themselves, which is something that a novelist would readily do, right? It would explore the psychology of conversion. Kish doesn't do that. He only hints here and there at grievances or resentments that might have played a part. I interpret this as Kish's avowal that his task is not to invent thought or a process of reasoning for characters whose significance lies entirely in their actions, in the results of their commitment. And I remember his enigmatic characters. Whenever the outrages of our own time in the cities of Europe and in the USA are followed by media interviews with baffled neighbors of the perpetrator, saying things like, he just seemed an ordinary guy, we had no idea. Kish's sense of the responsibility of fiction before history was very sharp. On one hand, fiction must recognize the reality of history. On the other, it has a margin of freedom that can be used to release the imagination, like a jester or genie, into the endless May Day parade of force that constitutes history with a capital H. The parade is real, the jester is fictional, and the jester's victories of wit and truth-telling are impossible, but they enlarge the imagination. They widen the scope of our sympathy. And this too is reality, although a second-order reality. Kish once told an interviewer that literature must correct history. He went on to explain, history is general, literature concrete. History is manifold, literature is individual. Literature corrects the indifference of historical data by replacing history's lack of specificity with a specific individual. Now, his terms here are drawn ultimately from Aristotle, who maintained something like the opposite, that history deals in particular facts while poetry deals with universal or general truths. But Kish's verbs there must correct. They have a different source. Leaving the modal auxiliary to one side, that must, that imperative which conveys his high sense of the mission of literature, the choice of correct, must correct history, is beautifully exact. Literature becomes an editor here with pen in hand, scanning the draft of history and making emendations, restoring the individual dimension which had been expunged. This puts literature in a superior position with power to alter the record of events. Yet the limitation of this role is also clear. It's inherent in the metaphor itself, what he would call the silly metaphor, because history with a capital H is not a text at all. It's not the aggregated chronicle of the past or an ideal historiography. It's a continuum of shattering collisions. It is that chain of events which Walter Benjamin's Angel perceived as a single catastrophe piling up ruins at its feet. History in this sense cannot be corrected except in the realm of imagination, where literature achieves its effects and secures whatever value it has. And Kish's precedent here is not Aristotle, it is Nietzsche. In The Birth of Tragedy, where he elaborates his view of Socrates as the new Orpheus who rose against the god Dionysus and vanquished him. In Nietzsche's account there, Socrates is the fateful figure who casts the shadow of insight over ancient Athens, negating the greatest accomplishments of Greek genius, the harbinger of modernity, which breaks up integrity and brings decadence, in which life no longer dwells in the whole. Socrates conceives it to be his duty to correct existence, writes Nietzsche teasingly or mockingly. Of course, existence is no more vulnerable to correction by Socrates than history is vulnerable to correction by novels. And yet, Nietzsche was convinced that Socrates' corrections had been all too deplorably successful in dimming the Dionysian brilliance of Greek culture. Ideas can inflect history with a capital H. If we know anything, working in universities, we know this. And by shaping the past They shape perceptions of the present and hence the conditions in which the future is constantly becoming the present, not the false fictitious future that moves like a locomotive on non-existent tracks, but the real fictitious future, which we imagine in a myriad ways and that ceases to be fiction only when it solidifies at our fingertips. And this is why Nietzsche can so urgently deplore the influence of Socrates, and why literature can, after all, in its way, correct history. A splendid correction of history was provided a few years ago in one of the countries that emerged from Yugoslavia, in Croatia. A writer and editor called Slavko Goldstein, who actually was Kish's publisher too, published a book in 2007 called 1941, The Year That Keeps Returning. The book examines the violence used in Croatia and Bosnia during the Second World War, and it traces how that violence engendered or helped to engender the violence which attended the destruction of Yugoslavia 50 years later. The claim of a causal connection between the two episodes has long been exploited by propagandists in the region, often to extenuate crimes. Before Goldstein, though, this claim had not been subjected to scrupulous examination on the ground by someone who had lived through both periods. Goldstein was qualified for this task by his own experience, and the book includes an account of the recovery of a letter from his father, Ivo Goldstein, to himself, written during the war. Ivo Goldstein was Jewish, as Slavko Goldstein is, and as such was soon arrested, jailed, and tortured by Croatia's pro-Nazi regime. That summer, 1941, Ivo Goldstein was killed in circumstances that the family would not learn about until much later. But fully 64 years would pass before the letter from father to son reached the son. Aged not 12, but 76, Slavko Goldstein received a sheet of paper, tightly folded, covered in faded pencil script, which had been found among the papers of a different Croatian writer, Vinko Nikolic is his name, who, as a nationalist, served that Quisling regime as an official, fled in 1945 before the Allies and the partisans, and remained loyal to that wartime regime for the rest of his life. I remember this man's public appearances in Croatia in the 1990s, when the new democratic regime not only permitted him home, but treated him as a heroic patriot. So the letter from father to son is a loving and encouraging and noble document. You should know, the father writes, that there are times when it is a greater honor to be in prison than outside it. Perhaps you are crying because your father is suffering an injustice. It is better to bear an injustice than to commit one, he writes. I want to show you another letter from the same period. This letter was written by Danilo's father, Edward, to his own sister, Danilo's aunt, in other words, in April 1942, so just less than a year after Ivo Goldstein's letter. This is one page of it. The letter was found among Edward's papers, which his widow and children took with them back to Yugoslavia in 1947. Kish's novel, Hourglass, is a vast commentary on this letter, and he included the letter at the end of his novel as a sort of guide to the contents. It's a brilliant device for structuring a novel. I don't know of anyone else who's done exactly that. As with our own lives, understanding in the novel comes retrospectively, if it comes at all. Kish used to say that the letter was authentic. He would say in interviews that the letter at the back of his novel was authentic. But this wasn't true. He had revised it. He'd moved material around, shaping it, deleting some bits, inserting allusions or metaphors that he wanted to elaborate in the novel. So you might say that his reworking of his father's letter was another form of the correction of history. The last correction that he made in that letter was the addition of a postscript. P.S. It is better to be among the persecuted than among the persecutors. That is the last line of the novel, and that's not in the original letter. You can imagine my surprise when I read Goldstein's book and found his father expressing in a letter almost the self-same moral principle that Kish made his father the fictional version of his father, write in a letter. Let me turn again to Aristotle's Poetics to try and convey the sense of the uncanny, really, which this coincidence creates. Just after that passage where he's discussed the difference between poetry and history, Aristotle says this. I won't read it out. Real events, he says, we know from our own lives that real events can be highly improbable. And in Aristotle's view, art needs to beware of such events. So I like to see it as confirmation that Ivo Goldstein's letter confirms the poetic precision of Kish's correction to his father's letter. For the postscript that he added to his father's letter, which falsified it as a document, turns out to have been what Aristotle called the sort of thing that would probably or inevitably happen. The sentence that Kish added is a quotation from the Talmud, attributed to Rabbi Abahu of Caesarea in a tractate called Bava Kamma, which is there at the bottom of the page. Kish placed the sentence here because he wanted, at the end of this novel about the struggle of a central European Jew against the forces that will make him disappear, he wanted to honour traditional moral thought. It contrasts the monstrous injustice of the persecution that oppresses E.S. with the ancestral wisdom of his people. Of course, the line has to work in a literary way, let's say dramatically, as well as philosophically. The postscript looks back into the difficult family relationships in the novel, particularly the strains between E.S. and his sister. The postscript turns that Talmudic axiom into a put-down. The persecution E.S. has in mind is the family bullying that he's been complaining about in that letter. E.S., therefore, may be a loser, but he is claiming moral superiority. So his intention is tainted by pettiness of a very human kind, yet the effect in the novel is not petty, or it's not only petty. It is also grand, perhaps because it faces forward into the future at the end of the book, the future where the author wrote the novel and where we read it. In its minuscule way, it signals that the West's finest moral traditions had survived the mid-century onslaught. I consulted a majestic edition of the Bava Kamma, the Schottenstein edition, which translates the rabbi's statement slightly differently, as one should always be among the pursued and not among the pursuers. And at the end of the editorial gloss, there's an unexpected sentence, a comment upon the principle which has been articulated. So at the end of the gloss, the editor adds, "One should rather choose, if one can, to be neither the pursuer nor the pursued." This is endearing and important. It comes as a reminder that life is best without pursuit of any kind. Such reminders are precious in a context of history with a capital H and of vertiginous moral dilemmas. But Kish, of course, is writing about situations where the choice of not having to choose was non-existent. Situations such as that in which Ivo Goldstein found himself in 1941. I wrote to Slavko Goldstein pointing out this coincidence, and he replied that indeed it was striking, and he had no doubt that his father, a grandson of a rabbi, would have known the sentence directly from the Talmud. But he added that if his father had written the letter just a month later, in June 1941, by which time the scale of persecution in Croatia was plain to see, then his father would not, he thinks, have included that sentence in his letter to him. What I take Slavko Goldstein to mean is that his father would have come to support resistance to injustice, not submission to it. For resistance to such persecution would have been preferable, even if it involved, as it could do, the perpetration of injustice in its turn, the dilemmas of resistance and so forth. I read this reflection in Slavko Goldstein's reply to me with surprise initially and then with relief. For surely he's right to defend his father in this way, by saying that the Socratic Talmudic principle is not absolute, for there are circumstances unimaginable to its originators in ancient Athens or Caesarea, where the cause of goodness and justice mandates action. Kish also chose this sentence to end his novel, I believe, because it is not only Jewish, it belongs to the commonwealth of moral wisdom beyond national or religious precincts. Kish believed fervently in the unity of European culture. He was a comparativist by training and a modernist by temperament as well as by fate, with a modernist sense of working in or across a living cosmopolitan tradition. To the best of my knowledge, the principle that filtered down nearly 2.5 millennia to Ivo Goldstein emerged in the Platonic dialogue called Gorgias. Polus takes up the question of what is the greatest good for humankind. He asserts that it is power. Socrates pushes back inch by inch until Polus concedes that suffering wrong is as nothing compared with inflicting wrong. More than this, the wrongdoer who is not punished is, Polus eventually accepts, more miserable than the one who is punished. Polus puts to Socrates the objection that anyone might put. It is terrible to suffer wrong. And Kish's novel Hourglass shows this with extraordinary vividness. So how can it be better? Polus denies that it is worse to suffer wrong, but he agrees that to do wrong is more shameful than to suffer it. This gives Socrates his foothold. He proposes that to inflict wrong is worse than to suffer it through an excess of evil. So it is not only more shameful to do wrong, it is also more evil. Polus is also led to accept that the life is most unhappy, which is afflicted with evil and does not shrive itself of this burden, does not get rid of this burden. And this man, Socrates says, for he has an open goal now, this man is the one who does the greatest wrong and indulges in the greatest injustice and yet escapes correction or punishment. Callicles then steps in, accusing Socrates of obstructing the attainment of wealth and honor. Happy is the man who has cultivated his appetites, says Callicles, and can satisfy them. Socrates engages and moves to the same conclusion as with Polus. From the start of Gorgias, Socrates has hardly resorted to his usual deflecting professions of ignorance. As the dialogue moves to its end, he is at full stretch, correcting existence for all he is worth, championing temperance and order against the world of disorder or riot, as he calls it, to substantiate his claim that it is as much more evil as it is more shameful to do than to suffer wrong. Eventually, his ground of demonstration becomes religious, as he proposes that the worst of all evils is to die and arrive in the other world with a soul surcharged with wicked deeds. The argument seems strongest when he first deals with Callicles, telling him that if he, Callicles, cannot substantiate his own claim about suffering, then, says Socrates, Callicles himself will not agree with you, Callicles, but will be at odds with you throughout your life. And I think it is better that my lyre should be discordant and out of tune, and that the majority of mankind should disagree with and oppose me, than that I, being one, should be out of harmony with and contradict myself. The moral principle or precept voiced by Socrates here was invoked in the 20th century by Hannah Arendt in her thinking about the Holocaust, above all in connection with the Eichmann trial in 1961. She called the Socratic axiom the basic assumption of all moral philosophy. I think it provided for her a point of orientation, a means of keeping her compass amid the moral apocalypse that was the subject of the trial that she was observing and writing about and thinking about. She was fascinated by Socrates' empirical claim about the necessity to be in harmony with oneself. She saw it as proof of the bifurcation of identity or the doubleness of consciousness. She said, nothing that is identical with itself, truly and absolutely one, like A is A, can be either in or out of harmony with itself. Articulating this being conscious of myself, I am inevitably two in one. And she connected this to Plato's definition elsewhere of thinking as the soundless dialogue between me and myself, arguing, she argued, that this dialogue is nothing less than the highest actualization of the human capacity for speech. This meditation leads Arendt on to a gloss on the great principle which goes beyond Socrates but is arguably implicit in Gorgias. She writes, "For Socrates, this two-in-one meant simply that if you want to think, you must see to it that the two who carry on the thinking dialogue be in good shape, that the partners be friends. It is better for you to suffer than to do wrong because you can remain the friend of the sufferer. Who would want to be the friend of and have to live together with a murderer? Not even a murderer," she concludes. This is a secular psychological correction of the religious ground that Socrates fell back on at the end of Gorgias. Arendt doesn't claim this is the only reason why it's better not to be a murderer. I'm not even sure she argues it's the principal reason. So she's not denying that you might object that it is better to suffer than cause suffering because we should do no harm, because causing suffering is a very bad thing to do. She's building up the hinterland of argument here to support her judgment that Eichmann was incapable of thought. That's where she's leading to and comes out. And for this reason, Eichmann was a negligible person, a nobody. Because if he had been capable of thought, he would have avoided those actions which would make his company intolerable to himself. In this circular vein, Arendt reaches the curious conclusion that the evil committed by nobodies is the greatest evil. I think we see here the strain of trying, as she's valiantly trying, to reconfirm Socrates' axiom for the 20th century as absolute. I think she's more convincing when she observes, splendidly and differently, that, I'm quoting next, "Morally, the only reliable people when the chips are down are those who say, I can't." That's the end of the quotation from Arendt. We, and indeed they themselves, can speculate about such people's inner state of harmony or disharmony and reach such conclusions as we or they may. But what matters, though, is that there is a moral limit beyond which they cannot go. Returning to Kish, he was not a philosopher, yet he was certainly a moralist, and he thought long about the moral problems that obsessed Arendt in the 60s and 70s, the same problems. And this thinking issued in fictional forms or forms of fiction, as well as in his non-fiction. Arendt was given to insisting that thought is an activity. Thinking, she wrote, unfreezes that which language has frozen into thought. And one ground for praising the novel Hourglass is to say that it dramatizes the activity that is thinking, the thinking which unfreezes thought. In this way, Kish has his place in the modernist tradition, born with James Joyce and Virginia Woolf more than a century ago. But unlike others in this tradition, he carries his modernist writing into the heart of 20th century darkness. This was his destiny, for he was raised in that darkness. It drove him and his family to hide and flee and hide again, and it swallowed up his father. Literature became the torch by which he could understand his place in this darkness and his relationship to it. Among his resources in this endeavor of understanding was the figure of the double. My perception of you is not yours of yourself. It doubles you. If I deny this is going on, I may efface your reality with my own version of it. This is why we all generate fiction as naturally as we breathe. The dynamics of perception in a novel are the means by which knowledge of character, situation, and plot is dispensed and controlled. Kish was fascinated by these dynamics, and his mastery of them is one great source of pleasure in his writing. But the fascination also had a political side. He was obsessed with the power of politics to affect people's lives, especially the power to affect them for the worse in the name of the better. Now, politics is history in the present tense, and this life-changing power is a matter of material strength, but also a matter of conviction. the proliferating energy of perception is dangerous when thwarted. If plurality presents as a threat of disintegration, the reaction will be a counter-movement that enshrines one's own integrity and sees others as a threat which may then justify resistance by any means. This is the background of Kish's polemical critique of nationalism, which he wrote in the early 1970s and became much cited during the wars of the 1990s and up to the present day. It's still quoted now as a standard reference on the subject. That's just a very small fraction of it. Kish found a model for thinking about nationalism in Jean-Paul Sartre's little book, Portrait of the Anti-Semite, which was written at the end of the Second World War. It's a brilliant performance, contending that anti-Semitism is not an opinion, but first and foremost a passion, a total outlook on the world, as Sartre called it, which is adopted of one's own free will, a philosophy of life brought to bear not only on Jews, but on all people, on history and society. Kish maps his portrait of a nationalist onto Sartre's portrait of the anti-Semite, and his portrait is of the local nationalists in Yugoslavia, the ones who used the language that he himself used. And to this end, he adds an extra feature to Sartre's portrait, and this feature is the sibling double. Sartre argued that the pressure of anti-Semitism compels the Jew to double himself, forces what Sartre calls a duplication of the fundamental relationship with others. Kish adapts this insight, and he describes the nationalist as one half of a whole, a being out of harmony with himself, in that phrase of Socrates, who is obsessed with defeating another, who is his own double, not only in virtue of their shared characteristics, but also because this other is, unbeknown to either party, the nationalist's own brother. This rivalry, blind rivalry between fraternal doubles, is Kish's extra ingredient in his portrait, and it fits onto the deadly rivalry between Serbs and Croats, more responsible than anything else for the internecine violence of the 1940s and the 1990s. Kish's archetypal nationalist, destitute of self-awareness, this individual without individuality, as he calls him, projects outwards the terror of disintegration and converts it into persecution. At Nuremberg, the former Nazi governor general of Poland, Hans Frank, announced his conversion to Roman Catholicism. Undergoing trial for war crimes and crimes against humanity, he expressed remorse. He said at one point, It is as though I am two people. Me, myself, Frank, here, and that other Frank, the Nazi leader. Sometimes I wonder how that man, Frank, could have done those things. Now, was this a calculating play or ploy for sympathy by a man who knew what sentence almost certainly awaited him? Or was it the naive expression of a disintegrated soul, so far out of harmony with himself that the very notion of harmony has no purchase? Or was it both of these? 60 years later, a very senior Bosnian Serb wartime leader called Momcilo Krajisnik was tried in The Hague for crimes against humanity during the war in Bosnia. The judgment noted Krajisnik's attempt to mislead the chamber into thinking he was a bureaucrat who dealt exclusively with inconsequential matters. The judgment also remarked on his very low credibility as a witness. And it noted, as an exception, what it called a rare moment of relative frankness when Krajisnik commented on something he had said during the war that was quoted back at him in the trial. In the war, Krajisnik had dismissed Muslim political identity, which was a constitutional fact in Yugoslavia since the 1970s, as a fiction. He said it was a fiction. When this was cited in his trial, he responded as follows. This is Krajisnik speaking in his own trial. This here is nonsense, what Momcilo Krajisnik was saying. It's detrimental. I have to say I never thought like this. If I could distance myself from this Momcilo Krajisnik, I would. this speech is absolutely authentic, and I'm very sorry that this Momchilo Krajishnik said what he said. Again, was this a cynical bid to persuade the chamber that he was a reformed man, or an expression of spiritless disintegration? Or does that question make little sense? Applying for early release, Krajishnik said he accepted the judgment and, quote, has deep remorse for the victims who have suffered as a result of the crimes which were committed and for which he was found guilty. Note the low cunning of the language. He also pledged to, quote, promote reconciliation in the former Yugoslavia. He was released, not then, but in 2013, after serving most of a 20-year sentence, and received a hero's welcome in Serb-controlled Bosnia. He has published a book, subsequently, that reiterates the familiar propaganda of half-truths and untruths about the war, which he and others uttered during the war. His nationalist prejudices and blinkers remain intact. He insists he was innocent, took part in no crimes, and his conscience is clear. Having followed Krajishnik's foul career, read extracts from his book, and even testified in his trial, I am tempted to confirm, in the spirit of Hannah Arendt, that he is indeed incapable of thought. But this diagnosis would hardly explain what he did, why he did it, and how he seems to live with himself very easily now, with little strain, if any. What does this mean? It means, to start with, that we must not define our intellectual definitions and categories to suit our convenience. The normal usage of words like think must be respected if we are to keep in contact with the world as it is. Krajishnik, alas, is somebody. He is not incapable of thought. He is a moral imbecile, which is not the same. In Socratic terms, Krajishnik had done evil, was punished for it, and presumably his soul was relieved of the burden of unshriven, unatoned for evil. If shriving the burden depends on recognition of the evil that one has done, then Krajishnik's burden remains squarely on his shoulders. But he doesn't feel it, so who are we to say that it is there at all? He gives no sign of awareness that he is in the unhappiness, that he gives no sign of awareness that he is in, supposedly, the unhappiest position a person can be in. But perhaps Socrates was incapable of conceiving of such a character. In Arendtian terms, he was incapable of recognizing what he had done. So his conscience could well be clear. Why not? I am uneasy with analysis that denies agency to a criminal who is clearly competent, not suffering from diminished responsibility. It looks like moving the goalposts, excluding Eichmann from the category of the thoughtful, because her prior definition of thoughtfulness should have made it impossible for him to do what he did. Kischer's literary portrait of a nationalist gets us further in comprehending Krajishnik and his like than Arendt gets us in comprehending Eichmann. There has been a defendant at The Hague, however, whose actions in detention showed the edifying sight, to my eye, of an individual achieving individuality, of a conscienceless person finding or making a conscience. This was Milan Babic, a leader of the Serb rebellion in Croatia in 1990 and 1991, charged with crimes against humanity and other offences by the prosecutor at The Hague Tribunal. Babic was initially named as a co-perpetrator in the Croatia indictment of Serbian President Milosevic. He contacted the tribunal and agreed to testify, but interviews with him then led to an indictment against him. Under a plea bargain with the prosecution, he entered a guilty plea and cooperated in his own case, but also in the trials of other indictees. He's not the only defendant to have pleaded guilty. Some 20 have done so, but Babic's statement stands out in this company for its grasp of what he had done, its expression of remorse without self-pity or sly attempts to defuse responsibility, and its reaching out to the former enemy. Let's see if it will work a bit.
Thank you, Your Honour.
I won't play you all. I think we can. I just want to take you to the key part. The voice you'll hear is his interpreter, not his own voice. But this is him making his plea. Where are we? Where are we?
The fact that we all belong to the same human race is more important than any differences. And I have come to understand that only through friendship and confidence we can live together in peace and friendship, and thus make it possible for our children to live in a better world. I have asked help from God to make it easier for me to repent, and I am thankful to God for making it possible for me to express my repentance. I ask for my brothers, from my brothers Croats, to forgive us, their brothers Serbs. And I pray for the Serb people to turn to the future and to achieve the kind of compassion that will make it possible to forgive the crimes. And lastly...
You heard him ask his brother Croats to forgive their brother Serbs. Recall Kish's savage portrait of the nationalist, who fears no one but his brother, his god made to his own measure, his double, at the next table. Babic committed suicide 2 years after this plea, while testifying in another trial. He left no note. In Socratic terms, Babic had no reason for despair. The worst was over. In the terms of Hannah Arendt, however, his final action has a terrible logic. If the price of recovering these most precious attributes, his humanity, and so forth, was the discovery that he could not live with himself, that the silent dialogue could not be conducted on tolerable terms, that integrity had been glimpsed but could not be secured. However, it would be ingenuous to propose a philosophical explanation of his suicide, and I'm certainly not doing that here. May we, though, grant him a measure of the generous understanding that he himself denied to the victims of his regime in 1991, and concede that he was, in his plea and his testimony in other trials, making a sincere and indeed courageous effort to correct history. I want to end on a note of positive admiration. So, let me say a little bit about how Kish's first life partner, his saputnica, reacted to the fighting in Croatia in autumn 1991. Mirjana Miocinovic was born in Belgrade, the capital of Yugoslavia and Serbia, and has lived there all her life. She was a senior and much respected teacher at the university there in the Department of Drama. Fighting in Croatia was gathering in scale and violence during the late summer and early autumn of 1991, when the Renaissance city of Dubrovnik in southern Croatia came under bombardment from sea and land. And Mirjana responded with a letter dated 7th of October 1991. And this is it. The highlights are mine, of course. I should add that there's an allusion there to the drama which had flourished in Renaissance Dubrovnik. At the same time as it was flourishing in London, it was flourishing there, and the dramas written in Renaissance Dubrovnik are still performed. The absurdity of her ultimatum in this letter is its point. It was utterly unreasonable. Either the war stops or I go. In that impossible demand lay the assumption of responsibility. She resigned the following week when the dean tried to have her sacked. She said afterwards that her action was just normal. That's how she is about herself. She said it's just normal, nothing to make a fuss about. Which, of course, it was not, except in the highest ideal sense. We remember Arendt saying morally the only reliable people when the chips are down are those who say, I can't. If we were to presume to correct Mirjana's letter to the university, we might do so by adding a postscript. P.S. It is better to be among the persecuted than among the persecutors. Thank you very much.
We have some time for questions. I would be delighted if we have some students
here, if we could get questions from students first. Well, we'll take questions from all of you.
Thanks very much for a really wonderful lecture. Could you say something about the education, the formation of quiche? Because you talk about classical moral theory, you talk about existentialism in a way through Arendt, and modernism. So are there are all these forces playing into his work. Because you don't give a conventional biography, we don't know, or I don't know, what kind of particular education he had.
Yes.
And whether or not the sources that you bring to bear on him were actually ones that he might also have turned to.
Thank you. The misfortunes of his life began to they began to ease when he moved to from a Hungarian village to post-war Yugoslavia. He went to a gymnasium in Cetinje, the old capital of Montenegro, which is still there, still famous, where he himself said he had an excellent education, partly thanks to the white Russians who had taken refuge in Montenegro following the Civil War and who taught maths and classics and other subjects. And he then went to Belgrade, where he took a degree in world literature. He was in the first intake in the new degree, which I do write about in the book. That degree has become legendary. It's still offered by the University of Belgrade. And he was trained in comparativism. I don't think there was a sort of heavily theoretical side to it at that point. I don't think there could have been 1954 in Belgrade, but the teachers were of very high quality. The man who conceived the degree was an exceptional intellectual himself, and a literary critic. Language teaching was an obligatory part of the degree. He was already bilingual in Hungarian. He became so in Russian and French. He was trained in comparative literature, I think, with more intellectual freedom and curricular freedom than anywhere else in Eastern Europe at that time. The man who designed the course got permission for example, for students to use the Bible and to have access to fiction, which was discouraged elsewhere. The students in Yugoslavia could read Kafka, for instance. So there was a vital margin of freedom which he used, and others too, which used to the full. And what would he have made of this gallimaufry? He read obsessively about the Holocaust, but he read with as a creative writer, someone who was looking for better ways to, I think, he's looking for ways to help him say what he wanted to say. He read Bruno Bettelheim. Did he read Hannah Arendt? I don't know. I didn't find Arendt among the books which he consigned to the Serbian Academy. I think the sort of comparative leaps which I was attempting to perform in some way are certainly in the spirit of his own writing. Yes. But I think he would have shaken his head at some of it.
Great. Next question. Yeah.
Uh, Mark, I want to focus on the issue about the harmony of the self and the central role that it played in your presentation of a kind of moral centering. I have not read any of Kish's novels, so your account of him is the one I've got. But it strikes me that his literary modernism and the way that he uses documentary evidence and then turns it into a literary story, things like this. Some of these techniques often go along with a literary ambition to avoid making a centralized self the core of a narrative. So that it seems like you were working against some of Kish's own literary grain in order to push the story of the moral centering, not just of him, but of other people in his milieu. So I'd like to draw you out a bit more on the resources that you turn to, for example, in the figure of Socrates and Gorgias, as opposed to the resources you draw on with Nietzsche, who certainly a lot of literary modernists took up as putting pressure on the notion of a centralized self as the locus of moral meaning. So tell me more about that.
Well, what you say about Kish's literary resistance to fiction, which presents, you know, well-integrated selves in stable social settings and so forth, that you're spot on, and I believe that his encounter with Ulysses, with Joyce, was really a very important, fortifying, heartening encounter for him, and liberating indeed. He didn't care for psychological realism, as he called it. He didn't write about the self in these terms, even against it. His object of attack would be psychological realism, which he thought as a genre of fiction was simply played out. He had nothing to say against the great classics of psychological realism from the 19th century, early 20th century, but he thought it was, he thought that, certainly that's not, but he thought that its time had gone. But of course, when creative writers talk in general terms like these, they are usually talking about the directions that they feel they can go in themselves, and the directions they want to explore, and the direction, and also they'll be talking against the directions that they feel are closed to them. So I'm not sure that all of this is a matter of objective, critical judgment. I think he was impelled, I mean, writers write what they can write, and he was impelled to write in the way that he did, and he found critical ideas. He was very interested in criticism. He wrote critical essays, and some of them are of pretty sort of serious journal type. But I think he devised critical ideas which would meet his own situation and which would answer to the challenges that he felt himself having to confront as a writer of fiction. Now, having said that, though, he was not, as regards as a sort of ethics, in any way a relativist or a postmodernist. Not at all. He maintained a rather old-fashioned demeanour in that way. He was, I think, immune actually to the currents of critical thinking, which were definitely vibrant in Paris, where he was living. He spent the 79 to 89 living in Paris. He would have been exposed certainly to the, you know, flood of very different thinking about the novel and the self and the ethical dimensions of that too. But I don't think he was interested. He'd been formed in a different milieu, elsewhere, and he was not open to it.
Next question. Yes.
Something I'm curious about after your presentation is what was his view of liberalism as a kind of social project? I mean, because my impression is that people who'd been through his types of experiences in Europe in the 20th century, in some cases came out as convinced liberals because that's the only bulwark against those things happening again, or they came out as general political skeptics who'd regard liberalism as one more ideology that has its own destructive potential. I'm wondering what your sense is of him.
He didn't express thoughts about political ideas. I mean, he did write a little bit about pluralism, a few pages, but he had in mind cultural pluralism. Now, whether he privately would have discussed political ideas in more detail, no one told me that he did. I think one reason for that would be his, he thought people should talk about what they knew, and he knew about literature. He did not like writers pontificating about politics, and he didn't do it. You could put everything he says directly about politics in all his nonfiction on two pages, or if not one. He was strongly anti-communist, and that's attested by friends, and there are episodes of him, you know, banging his fist on the table and really insulting people in a way which isn't done in Western Europe. You know, and there was a mismatch there in terms of sometimes his social behaviour in France. He would offend people by expressing himself extremely vehemently on the question of communism. And for example, he would have nothing to do with the notion that Yugoslav communism was better. And if you had anything to do with the study of Yugoslav, post-war Yugoslavia or comparative models of communism, you'll be aware of all the writing that there was about the self-management model and so forth. He wouldn't hear it. Absolutely wouldn't hear it. Communism is communism. And it can be dressed up as self-management or as workers' councils or whatnot, but it's illiberal. So his notion of liberalism would be very, very simple, that it would be sort of parliamentary and pluralist, and that it would involve guaranteed human rights. But he didn't talk about such things. He manifested his convictions about pluralism in his fiction. In Hourglass, for example, which is a prominent work. It's mixing the genres and conventions and voices.
If I may just add one real quick...
That hasn't quite been a satisfactory answer.
Well, I'm just wondering, if he lived in France for 10 years, do you get a sense of how he liked it? I mean, my impression is that much of the French literary milieu would have leaned left and been quick to say, well, the communist bloc might be bad, but look at all the bad things here. Would he be the odd man out in those conversations?
You're spot on. And Pascal, who was his partner in those 10 years, has many stories to tell about how angry he would become, enraged indeed, by bien-pensant Parisian leftists talking, for example, criticizing Solzhenitsyn. He wouldn't have that. He thought Solzhenitsyn was a heroic witness and a teller of truth. And the idea that he was somehow a tool of anti-Soviet, this and that. Some of you will be familiar with these terms from long ago, but he wouldn't have it. And indeed, he wrote a tool for Boris Davidovich, this wonderful book, Stories About Stalinism, essentially, because he was a lector at Bordeaux University in 73, 74, 75, I don't know. And he was flabbergasted by student leftists who would tell him, and Solzhenitsyn was very much discussed at that time because the Gulag Archipelago was being published by an emigre press in France. And so this was being discussed, and Kish could not believe these French bourgeois children, as he saw it, telling him what communism was really like. So he found that the only way that he could get across to them, could get through their prejudices, was by telling stories about actual individuals, or at least elaborated stories of incidents and people. And that's how he came to write that series of stories, because that was a way of puncturing ideological prejudice of Parisian, of French leftists. So yes, you're spot on about that. Pascal said that when she remembers a time when they were in a bar with communist workers. Kish was a heroic drinker and would drink with anyone when the mood was on him. And she said he was very nice with the worker communists, because their communism came out of their experience, and he respected it. So he didn't agree with it, but he didn't find it objectionable that they should have these beliefs. But the student communists, he had it down.
So we have time for one more question from Felipe.
Well, I'll have to ask this with greater precision than I usually manage when I only have time to listen to the answer. But it does kind of follow on from Tom's and Alex's questions. I was thinking about his historical education, which I presume was Marxist, essentially, and that therefore the history that he was seeking to correct in his fiction was Marxist history. And what I very much appreciated the brilliance with which you related his texts on that point to Aristotle and Nietzsche. But was he not reacting to the facelessness of, you know, this vast, impersonal, economically determined kind of history? When you were talking about that, you know, I was thinking of that painting of Kyrikos in which Clio is shown with all her traditional iconographical appurtenances, but she has no face. And isn't that what he meant when he said he was restoring through fiction the individual experience that the kind of history that he learned didn't have?
Yes. Yes, you're right. I don't know how much of the historical teaching which would have been drummed into their heads at the gymnasium in Montenegro. Certainly they would have got, because this was the high tide of Yugoslav Stalinism, actually, 47, 48, 49. I don't think that got in there. I mean, I think he had native resources for resisting it. His friends, whom I've met, who are still alive, have very much conveyed a sense of a band of young, skeptical people for whom the historic Montenegrin environment was actually one means of resistance against the newfangled communist imposition. Cetinje was the royal capital of old Montenegro, with epic stories of fighting the Turks and so forth. Nationalist, of course, but it meant at least that he was exposed to debate, dialogue, and disagreement. At home, too, Kish's uncle, who raised him after the death of his father and mother, was a historian who was not a communist, and whose own writings are very methodologically scrupulous in looking at Montenegrin history. And Kish always paid tribute to that environment as having been formed. His uncle would make him read encyclopedias when he had questions or was spouting off, as we all did do. He would tell him to go and read encyclopedias, French encyclopedias. So, the monolithic type of a communist dogmatic history would have been pushed at him in school, and even also at university to some extent, but he gives every sign of having also had contrary influences which helped him to develop skepticism and independence from when he was a boy, and clearly they worked. I mean, they had their effect, their decisive effect on him. And as I say, there was this margin of freedom that was there in the Belgrade University, in Yugoslav universities, more I suspect in Belgrade than elsewhere in that time. And that would have made a difference too.
Well, thank you very much, Mark. We have a couple of things to give you. First of all, we're very proud of this. Here is the plaque that we're awarding you for the Laura Shannon Prize. We hope you will find a nice place for that. And nothing else now? Nothing else now. Okay.
This is enough.
Yes, this is it. I just want to thank you so much. This was a really, really remarkable lecture that you provided, touched on so many issues that concern us here at Notre Dame and that concern us as human beings, how we should act, also our struggles with trying to understand why other people act in the irresponsible and inhumane ways in which they do. So thank you again so much for this wonderful lecture.
Thank you.